April 29th, 1945. The Soviet armies have fought their way to the very heart of Berlin. Adolf Hitler and his remaining staff are trapped in their bunker deep beneath the Reichschancel. With all hope abandoned, Adolf Hitler takes an extraordinary step. He marries Eva Braun, the woman who has been his mistress for 14 years. Eva Braun's influence on Nazi government and politics has been almost negligible. But she does leave behind one remarkable legacy. A film record of her years spent in the company of Hitler's inner circle. Eva Braun's first job at the age of 17 had been as a photographer's assistant. At the Berghof, Hitler's mountain retreat in Bavaria, she will rarely be without her movie camera. The result will be an astonishing record of the Nazi leadership. Even in the informal setting of the Berghof, Adolf Hitler's relationship with Eva Braun is known to only a few. One journalist who showed too much curiosity about the subject quickly found himself in Dachau concentration camp. Hitler had first met Eva Braun in October 1929. At the Munich photography shop where she worked. The owner of the shop, Heinrich Hoffmann, here conversing with Hitler, was the official photographer to the Nazi party. Some months after their first meeting, Hitler and Eva met once more at Hoffmann's Munich house. Before the end of 1931, she had become Hitler's mistress. She was 19, 23 years younger than Hitler. For years, Eva Braun would be able to travel with Hitler and reside for long periods at the Berghof only because she could still pass as Hoffmann's assistant. Most of the film shot by Eva Braun is set in and around the Berghof between 1939 and 1944. It was in 1929 that Hitler first began to visit the area of the Obersalzberg, a holy mountain of the Germans in Upper Bavaria. The nearby town of Berchtesgaden had a population of only 3,500. It was a perfect retreat from the turbulent world of Bavarian politics. By 1925, Hitler had rented a house on the slopes of the Obersalzberg above Berchtesgaden. In 1928, he bought the property. When Hitler became Chancellor of Germany in 1933, Berchtesgaden found itself center stage in German politics. The man who had taken upon himself the task of transforming Hitler's modest mountain retreat into a vast and luxurious estate was Martin Bormann. Bormann, here with Hitler, would remain virtually unknown to the German people. Shunning publicity, he would rarely allow himself to be photographed or filmed. Martin Bormann had risen to power as the party fundraiser and had taken control of Hitler's personal finances. At first, the Berghof property consisted of only a few small woodlands round the house. Bormann set about acquiring the neighboring land. In time, the Berghof estate came to cover 6 square miles and 200 acres of farmland. The funds used by Bormann for his project came from the ever-increasing royalties from the sale of Hitler's book Mein Kampf and the millions of marks contributed by the wealthy to the Hitler Fund. But in keeping with Hitler's desire to project an unworldly image, and true to Bormann's own grasp of nature, the entire property was registered in Bormann's name. Bormann's desire to please Hitler knew no bounds. On one occasion in 1938, Hitler had complained that a cottage below the Berghof spoiled the view. Bormann paid an enormous sum for the cottage to be vacated. By the following day, it had been demolished and the site landscaped. The presence of Hitler at the Berghof for lengthy periods of time had meant that an increasing number of meetings and conferences were held there, rather than in Berlin. As a result, the party chancellery had opened a branch nearby. Barracks had been constructed for SS and security service bodyguards. A comfortable hotel for extra guests had been built within easy reach. The Berghof had, in effect, become an alternative seat of government. The house itself had been extended in 1935. It had grown to 3 stories high with over 30 rooms. Hitler had drawn up the plans himself. The centerpiece of the conference room is an enormous window whose glass can recede into the floor. On the second story, Hitler has a living room, a bedroom, and an office. Nearby is a suite reserved exclusively for Eva Braun. From 1936, she takes up almost permanent residence. Abandoning for a while her role as amateur filmmaker, Eva Braun is herself filmed with Margareta Speer in the valley below the Berghof. Margareta is the wife of Albert Speer, architect and from 1942, Reichsminister for Armaments and Production. Hitler's chauffeur, Eric Kempke, has described Eva Braun as the unhappiest woman in Germany. From the earliest days of her relationship with Hitler, she'd been forced to spend most of her days simply waiting. Her ambiguous status in the eyes of the Nazi high officials and their wives was for her a source of constant and acute embarrassment. She never ceased to hate what she called her backstreet existence. Back in 1935, Hitler had realized that he could not hope to keep his relationship with Eva secret while she was living in a Munich apartment block. He arranged for her to move into an expensive villa on the outskirts of the city. Already, Eva had attempted suicide twice, unable to cope with her life of isolation and secrecy. But now, for the first time, she is truly happy. She is free to come and go as she pleases, and no longer believes she has anything to fear from Hitler's many other female admirers. Eva's faith in Hitler is unshakable, even when she had learned of the Röhm purge of 1934, in which hundreds of Hitler's SA opponents had been murdered on his orders, her opinion had not changed. Eva's parents were strict Catholics. Their initial reaction to discovering their daughter's affair with Hitler was one of outright fury. But they made no attempt to break up the relationship, for fear of losing their daughter. Here at her villa, Eva films her sisters, Ilse and Gretel, and her mother, Franziska. So confident is Hitler in the secrecy of his relationship with Eva Braun that she, her sisters and friends can set out on a carefree Sunday cycling trip with apparently no security precautions whatsoever. As a child, Eva Braun had been described by a teacher as intelligent, but spending much of her time in class being a troublemaker. Her real interests were not academic, but sporting. She was an accomplished swimmer, dancer, and ice skater. When Eva was 16, her parents were convinced that a convent school would tame their frivolous and uncontrollable daughter. She was sent to the small town of Simbach, where an English order of nuns ran a school for young girls. Coincidentally, Simbach was directly across the Inn River from the Austrian town of Braunau. In 1928, Braunau was already gaining fame as the birthplace of Adolf Hitler. Shot before September 1939. After the invasion of Poland and the outbreak of war, Hitler will take to wearing military uniform for all formal occasions, a sign of his status as commander-in-chief of the German armed forces. On June 17th, 1939, one of the many state visitors to the Berghof is filmed being greeted by Hitler's staff. The visitor is the special envoy of the King of Saud, the royal advisor Khalid al-Hut. He's accompanied by the chief translator of the German Foreign Office, the envoy Paul Schmidt. Following is the chief adjutant of the SA, Wilhelm Bruckner. By 1939, Eva has become the unofficial hostess of Hitler's social functions at the Berghof. All know that Eva Braun and Martin Bormann dislike each other intensely, but the hostility between them will never turn to outright argument. Eva will be one of the few against whom Bormann will never intrigue. Adolf Hitler, genial though he could be with favorites such as photographer Hoffmann and Bormann himself, was capable of flying into a rage that could prove fatal to anyone who provoked it. June the 12th, 1939. Eva Braun films Hitler and his retinue on a visit to a one-room primary school which had become a minor shrine of National Socialism. Here, between 1895 and 1897, in the village of Fischlam near Lambach, Adolf Hitler had been to school. Leaving the school with Hitler is Martin Bormann, wearing his Brown Party uniform. By 1939, Bormann is ranked next in the party hierarchy to Deputy Führer Rudolf Hess. Bormann has already proved himself to be a man of ruthless ambition who believes in nothing but the exercise of power. When Hess flies to Britain in 1941, Martin Bormann will become minister in charge of party headquarters. It will be a position of extraordinary power. It will allow Bormann to control the most valuable commodity in the Reich, access to Adolf Hitler himself. In May 1945, Bormann will poison himself in a Berlin street rather than fall into the hands of the Red Army. His body will not be found until December 1972. July the 12th, 1939. Yet another sentimental trip for Adolf Hitler. This time, he is visiting a 3-hectare farm in the village of Hafeld. It is the farm to which his father, a customs official, had retired with his family in the spring of 1895. On Eva Braun's return to Munich from each stay at the Berghof, she would train her camera on members of her family. Close though her family ties seemed to have been, they would never override her devotion to him. Her sister, Gretel, will, in 1944, marry Hermann Fegelein, SS adjutant to Hitler. In the closing days of the war, Fegelein will be executed at the instigation of Bormann on Hitler's orders. He will have been caught deserting from the Reichschancellery bunker. Eva Braun does not intercede for her sister's husband. By then, she'll be so devoted to Hitler that in her eyes, treachery will be unforgivable. Better, she declares, that 10,000 die than that he be lost to Germany. July the 6th, 1940. Eva Braun films from the window in the old Reichschancellery in Berlin. Adolf Hitler's motorcade is expected to arrive at any moment. Hitler is returning to the German capital for the first time since his lightning conquest of Western Europe. The nearest Eva Braun comes to the official reception is her vantage point above the Wilhelmplatz. The conquest of France and the Low Countries reaffirms Hitler's belief in the destiny of Nazi Germany. Here, Hitler discusses developments with Hermann Esser. Esser, on the right, had been a co-founder of the original German Workers' Party from which the Nazi Party had developed. He was the first man to publicly call Adolf Hitler the Führer. Hitler has no doubts concerning his own destiny. He believes he has been sent by heaven to lead the German nation to greatness. His confidence in himself and his own judgment has never been greater. Hitler has clearly described the strength of his belief in himself. He has said, "I go the way that Providence dictates with the assurance of a sleepwalker." Hitler's arrogance and self-absorption are reflected in his view of his relationship with Eva Braun. It is a fact, he declares, that women love real men. It is their instinct that tells them they should seek the protection of a hero. For her part, Eva Braun had long since promised that she would follow Hitler to prison, deportation, or death. It is a promise that she will choose to keep. For many years, Hitler had been planning a series of grandiose buildings and monuments for the glorification of the Reich. Berlin, he had said, must be the true center of Europe, a capital that for everyone shall be the capital. Here, Hitler speaks to the sculptor and designer Arno Brecker. Once an internationally respected artist, Brecker's ambition had led him to specialize in gigantic representations of heroic Aryan figures. His work is so admired by Hitler that he has become virtually the official Nazi sculptor. Already, one journalist had been banned from his profession for neglecting to praise Brecker in an article on young sculptors. Ambassador Walter Hebel, the permanent delegate of the foreign minister, joins the conversation to explain the workings of his new cabinet. Arno Brecker introducing his wife to Hitler. That she is a foreigner causes no difficulty. She is a Greek, and according to Brecker, inspires his work. Hitler believes ancient Greece to have been an Aryan civilization. At the Berchtesgarten, Hitler likes to surround himself with an atmosphere of culture. The conversation regularly turns to art and architecture. Considering himself an artist, Hitler will invariably launch into a lengthy monologue on the subject. Hitler believes that there is only one man capable of producing public buildings worthy of the Third Reich. That man is Albert Speer, seen here on the right. For several years, Speer has had his own house on the Berghof estate, complete with an architect's office and all paid for by Hitler. A new set of drawings will always guarantee immediate access to the Führer's presence. Speer had first come to Hitler's attention by making the technical arrangements for the 1934 party rally. The spectacular displays of the 1935 rally had also been Speer's creation. He soon becomes, in effect, Hitler's court architect, responsible for designing the ostentatious buildings so loved by the Führer. As Minister of Armaments, Speer, here next to Hitler, proves himself an exceptionally able administrator, revolutionizing German arms production. At the Nuremberg trials, Speer will plead guilty and serve 20 years in Spandau prison. Joachim von Ribbentrop, Hitler's foreign minister from 1938. It was Ribbentrop's support for the annexation of Austria and the invasion of Czechoslovakia which gained him his ministerial post. In June 1945, he will be arrested and later tried at Nuremberg. Ribbentrop will claim to have known nothing of racial extermination or other Nazi crimes. Nevertheless, he will be found guilty and hanged. Adolf Hitler and his guests, with Bormann to Hitler's left, set off to visit the Kelstein, the mountain tea house which will become known as the Eagle's Nest. The building of the Eagle's Nest had been undertaken by Bormann as a birthday present for Hitler. It is Bormann's greatest extravagance yet. The access road alone had involved a major feat of engineering. It is nearly 4.5 miles long, with tunnels cut into the rock face. Long delays in construction had been caused by Hitler forbidding blasting during the morning because it disturbed his sleep. The road winds over 5,500 feet above sea level, ending abruptly at a pair of copper and bronze doors. The summit is reached by a 400-foot vertical lift shaft. Bormann's luxurious mountain tea house cost 30 million marks, a fortune in pre-war Germany. Hitler in conversation with one of his personal surgeons, Professor Karl Brandt. In 1945, Hitler will attempt to have Brandt executed for planning his family's escape. He will in fact be hanged by the Americans for his part in SS medical experiments. God at the Berghof is an SS detachment of the Liebstandarte Adolf Hitler. The Liebstandarte had begun as a hand-picked elite formed from the general SS. The selection of all SS members is on the grounds of racial purity and physical stature. All had their ancestry investigated back to 1750. Ironically, because the identity of Hitler's paternal grandfather was unknown, the Führer himself would have been ineligible for membership. The first commander of Hitler's Liebstandarte bodyguard had been Josef Sepp Dietrich. In the First World War, Dietrich had been a sergeant major. In the chaotic post-war years, he'd become heavily involved in right-wing paramilitary groups. Dietrich had joined the SS in 1928, quickly rising to become a major general. In 1940 and 1941, Dietrich had led the 1st SS Panzer Division in France, Greece, and Russia. After the D-Day landings in June 1944, Dietrich will command the 3 divisions of the 1st SS Panzer Corps. Dietrich's flair is not for strategy, but for leadership. He is widely regarded as the soldier's soldier. In late 1944, Hitler will give Dietrich command of Germany's last desperate offensive in the West. At the Battle of the Bulge, Dietrich's assault will be finally defeated only by Allied air power. After its failure at the Bulge, Dietrich's army will be moved south to the defense of Vienna. The advancing Russians will there destroy the remnants of his forces. Hitler's furious reaction will be to dismiss his old friend and to order the Liebstandarte demoted from its place as his elite force. Dietrich will succeed in avoiding capture by the Red Army and will surrender his remaining units to the Americans in May 1945. An American court will sentence him to 25 years imprisonment, of which Dietrich will serve less than 10. On his release, a German court will sentence him to 18 months for his part in the murder of SA men during Hitler's purge of 1934. Sepp Dietrich will die a free man in April 1966. In the films of Eva Braun, Hitler is constantly seen in the company of children. His favorite is Oshi Ostermeyer, daughter of Frau Hartz Ostermeyer, Eva Braun's close friend. Perhaps the many scenes of children filmed by Eva reflect her own hopes. It is certain that, to all those who knew her, Eva Braun's ambition seemed to go no further than the desire to be a good housewife. Never had more than the most superficial interest in politics. After Hitler was first introduced to her, she later asked the photographer Hoffman, "Who is Adolf Hitler?" The housekeeper at Hitler's Munich apartment had described Eva Braun as not very intelligent, just a pretty dog. Eva rarely indulged in serious conversation. At Hitler's social gatherings, she could get by. She'd picked up some knowledge from Hitler's long discourses, but her real interests lay elsewhere. When she was not photographing or processing film, Eva occupies her time watching romantic films, in sport, and in keeping animals. She loves clothes and cheap novelettes. Her taste for dancing, drinking, and smoking earn Hitler's displeasure, but she persists in secret. Hitler's own explanation for choosing such a simple companion was blunt. "Eva keeps my mind off things I don't want to think about. She gives me rest." Gretel Braun, sister of Eva and future wife of the doomed SS officer, Hermann Fagel. With Gretel is the district leader of Nivelle, Adolf Hoffmann. Hoffmann, Eva Braun's nominal employer, speaks to Hitler's surgeon, Professor Braun. The ritual after lunch stroll to the Muslim tea house, a 15-minute walk from the Berghof. Every day, Hitler chooses someone to walk with him ahead of the party. The rest maintain a respectful distance. Today, Hitler's choice is Albert Speer. There is fierce competition between members of Hitler's entourage for the priceless privilege of a private conversation with the Führer. On the right, leading against the fence, is Gerda, the wife of Martin Bormann. Encouraging the film actress Magda Schneider to approach Hitler is Marion Schoenemann, a friend of Eva Braun from Vienna. Marion Schoenemann is only one of a string of actresses invited to the Berghof by Martin Bormann. He propositioned virtually everyone. Dr. Joseph Goebbels, chief propagandist of the Nazi Party and propaganda minister, arrives at the Berghof. Goebbels' rise in the party hierarchy has been meteoric. Since 1933, all art, literature, music, and journalism had fallen under Goebbels' control. It had been Goebbels, as district leader of Berlin, who had introduced the phrase Heil Hitler as the official greeting between party members. His devotion to Hitler will never falter. After Hitler's death, Goebbels will have his children poisoned before he and his wife ask to be shot by SS men. Hitler with his Air Force adjutant, Nicholas von Bellof. His personal chief adjutant, Wilhelm Bruckner, in party uniform, is also there. Hitler, in an intimate discussion with his army adjutant, Gerhard Engel. The arrival of the Foreign Office Minister, von Ribbentrop. On the left is Heinrich Himmler, head of the SS. Beside him is Reinhard Heydrich, chief of the SD security service. Heydrich, the man responsible for organizing the extermination camp system, will be assassinated in Prague in May 1942. In 1945, Himmler will commit suicide by poison after his capture by British military police. Gretel Braun with Ambassador Walter Hebel. Gretel's marriage to Hermann Fegelein in 1944 will allow Eva Braun a degree of freedom she's never before enjoyed, because she can be introduced as the sister-in-law of Himmler's liaison officer to the Führer. Eva will be allowed to appear with Hitler publicly in Berlin. Eva's newfound freedom will be short-lived. By the time of her sister's wedding, the Third Reich will be less than 1 year away from total destruction. By 1944, even the isolated Berghof has been equipped with a vast complex of underground air raid shelters. An extensive system of tunnels and cubicles has been built for Hitler and his immediate staff. A second shelter, with an area of 1,000 square feet, has been built for Martin Bormann's own family and assistants. The Berghof shelters are deep inside the Obersalzberg mountain, protected by 170 feet of solid rock. But conditions are far from primitive. There is a water supply and air conditioning. There are marble tiles, parquet flooring, and fortified machine gun positions at the entrances. Whenever Allied aircraft are reported approaching, the entire valley can be camouflaged with artificial fog. In fact, the Berghof complex will not suffer from Allied bombing until 14 days before the end of the war. Then, it will be virtually obliterated. Neither Hitler nor Eva Braun will be there. Both will be deep in the Führer's bunker in the besieged city of Berlin. On February 8th, 1945, Hitler had instructed Eva Braun to return to the Berghof. She was to prepare for the reception of Hitler and his staff in case he should decide to conduct his operations from there. But Eva had no intention of leaving Hitler. While others had fled Berlin, she had returned to the Reichschancellery. Eva Braun would never leave Hitler's side again. Until now, Hitler had not abandoned hope that Berlin could be relieved. But by April the 28th, it had become clear that the army he expected to save him existed only in his own imagination. It was from Radio Stockholm that the final blow came. Heinrich Himmler was reported to be negotiating surrender with the Western Allies. To Hitler, it is the ultimate treachery. It is clear that all is now lost. The only senior Nazi figures remaining in the Reichschancery bunker are Hitler, Bormann, and Goebbels. Soviet tanks are now within a few hundred yards of the chancellery. The building above the bunker has been blasted to rubble. It is on the night of the 28th of April that Hitler finally decides to grant Eva Braun her long-held wish to become his wife. Between 1 a.m. and 3 a.m. on the morning of the 29th, an official of the Berlin Municipal Administration conducted the marriage of Adolf Hitler and Eva Braun. As demanded by Nazi law, both swore that they were of completely Aryan descent. While signing the marriage register, Eva began to write her surname as Braun. She stopped writing, crossed out the B and wrote, Eva Hitler. Goebbels and Bormann signed as witnesses. After the wedding, a breakfast was held complete with champagne. To one of the servants, Eva is overheard to say, you may safely call me Frau Hitler. Hitler had already composed his last testament. In it, he has written, my wife and I choose to die in order to escape the shame of overthrow or capitulation. It is our wish that our bodies be burned immediately. At 3:30 p.m. on the 30th of April, Hitler and Eva retired to Hitler's apartments. Eva Braun took poison. Hitler shot himself. No trace of their bodies has ever been found.